By the authority given in the statutes of the Open University, I declare this congregation open for the conferment of degrees and the presentation of graduates. Distinguished guests, graduates, and friends of the university, it's my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all to the 15th of the Open University's degree ceremonies being held in 2014. We are delighted to welcome Mr. Nick Barley, Director of the Edinburgh International Book Festival, the Reverend Dr. George Grubb, former Lord Provost of Edinburgh, Professor Stuart Munro, Scientific Director of Our Dynamic Earth, and Mr. Ken Muir, Chief Executive of the General Teaching Council for Scotland. Mr. Fraser Dury, Principal of Argyll College, Ms. Jan Hulme, University Secretary of Glasgow Caledonian University, and Professor Nigel Seaton, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of Abertay University, all of whom have found time in their very busy diaries to be with us today. Welcome. Finally, it's my great pleasure, though, to welcome our honorary graduates, Professor Sir John Arbuthnott and Dr. James Robertson. We are delighted to be able to honour both of them today. Each year, the Open University awards over 14,000 degrees, and throughout 2014, 7,000 of the graduates are being presented for their qualifications at degree ceremonies, such as this one today here in Edinburgh. They're being held in 13 different towns and cities across the UK, as well as in Dublin, in Versailles, and other places as far apart as Moscow, Bucharest, and Addis Ababa. This illustrates the extraordinary scale, scope, and reach of the Open University, underlying the fact that today you're joining a worldwide community of graduates. It goes without saying that today is a very important occasion in the life of you, our graduates, your families and loved ones, as well as the university staff, who I hope you will feel have nurtured and supported you. You could be forgiven for feeling that the occasion is so important that it needs to be a solemn one. You'd be quite wrong. In every sense of the day, it's a celebration. So I'm going to be very disappointed if anyone crosses the stage today with anything less than thunderous applause, or whatever other way you choose to express your enthusiasm and support. So with that in mind, I'd like to have a practice. Could our graduates please stand? Now, with all your well wishes here and family, I hope that you will join me in practicing the kind of celebratory noise I expect to hear as they cross the stage later. Better. Could we practice one last time, please? Congratulations to our graduates. Okay, so that was marginally better. I expect it to continue as we go through the ceremony today. So today's ceremony is going to begin with the awarding of the honorary degree of Doctor of the University to Sir Professor Sir John Arbuthnott. Dr. James Miller, Director of the Open University in Scotland, will present Sir John, who will sign the honorary graduate book, and he will then make a reply. Following this, we'll see the presentation of those graduates who have gained a higher degree and have been able to attend here today, and they'll be presented by Mrs. Lucy McLeod, Deputy Director of the Open University in Scotland, and then they will join us on the stage, joining the Academy. We'll then see the awarding of the honorary degree of Doctor of the University to Dr. James Robertson by Professor Rebecca Taylor, Dean and Director of Studies in the Open University's Business School. She will present Dr. Robertson, who will sign the honorary graduate's book, and then he will make a reply. Then we'll finally continue to the presentation of all our lovely graduates down here who've gained their first degrees, and these will be presented by Dr. Pete Kennell, Deputy Director of the Open University in Scotland. And to conclude the ceremony, I'll give a personal address to the graduates.
Thank you. Pro Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, graduates and guests. Professor Sir John Peebles Arbuthnott is one of Scotland's most highly respected academics and now holds the prestigious position of President of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Sir John read microbiology and developed a highly successful internationally recognised academic career with an enviable publishing record in Glasgow, Nottingham, London, New York and Dublin before being appointed as Principal and Vice-Chancellor of Strathclyde University in 1991, where he remained until 2000. Highly respected by his peers within academia, Sir John was elected convener of the Committee of Scottish Higher Education Principals and Vice-Chair of what is now Universities UK. Sir John's influence stretches well beyond academia, and he has held a number of key positions in Civic Scotland and across the United Kingdom. As a founder member of the UK Food Standards Agency, he also led the FSA in Scotland, improving food safety. Within healthcare, Sir John was chair of Greater Glasgow Health Board for 5 years, where he was instrumental in the development of the Glasgow Centre for Population Health in 2004, and he remains one of their external advisors. The centre has excelled in generating insights and evidence, creating new solutions and providing leadership for action to improve health and tackle inequality. Sir John also chaired the committee charged with reviewing the allocation of health resources in Scotland, and the resultant report, Fair Shares for All, was the basis for a new way of thinking of how healthcare services in Scotland should be resourced. Internationally, having recognised that countries in Africa faced a shortage of qualified cancer physicians and nurses, Sir John was the co-founder of the African Cancer Control Programme, AfrOx. AfrOx's mission is to partner with African countries and help them implement comprehensive cancer prevention and control programmes. Sir John was also a member of the Medical and Scientific Advisory Board and is chairman to the Laminar Biomedical Limited Board. With a mission to research and develop healthcare products, particularly on respiratory diseases such as cystic fibrosis and chronic obstructive airways disease. Other roles include chairing the expert group on Labour's plan for national care services, the Joint Information Systems Committee, and the Commission on Boundary Differences and Voting Systems. The theme running throughout Sir John's distinguished career is fairness and justice, which of course resonates loudly with the Open University's values. We are delighted to have Sir John's assistance in developing our research strategy. Sir John's most recent appointment is as the President of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Scotland's National Academy. Its mission is to advance learning and useful knowledge, and by doing so, it supports the cultural, economic and social well-being of Scotland and its people. We are delighted to be able to recognise Sir John's illustrious career, and we are honoured that he has accepted our honorary degree. Pro Vice-Chancellor, by the authority of Senate, I present to you for the degree of Doctor of the University, Professor Sir John Arbuthnott.
Pro Vice-Chancellor, I'm deeply grateful for being honoured by the Open University in this way. As you have said, that among many other things, I had the privilege quite recently of working with the Open University on the development of its research programmes. As we all know, it operates on a very wide basis across the world, and the record of its success is outstanding. Since its inception in 1970, more than 2 million people have actually benefited from its educational programmes. Many of these have gone on to, of course, develop their careers and go from success to success. Others have chosen to do things of particular interest to them. But as you said, Vice Chancellor, in terms of fairness, which is something that I am completely committed to, you have created, through the Open University, a fair and quite different university. In preparing for this, you get a little summary which tells you what to do. And it says, after the award of the honorary degree, you make a few short remarks. Short is underlined in bold. And this reminds me of a story of a very... a short story. This reminds me of a very famous Edinburgh professor who was one of the first people from the United Kingdom to visit Japan after the Second World War. After the formalities of the day, there was a special dinner in the evening with quite a large gathering, very enjoyable, many courses, and at the end of that, the chairman turned to him and said, "Now you make a speech." "But I don't know any Japanese, I can't say anything." "Don't worry," said the chairman. "You stand, you bow to the left, you bow to the right, you bow to the centre, you sit down. Say nothing." So he stood up and he bowed to the left, the centre, the right, sat down. There was thunderous applause. Like most professors, he could not resist doing this again. So he did the three things again, sat down, and there was total silence. So he turned in an embarrassed way to his host and said, "What's wrong?" And his chairman said, "Speech too long." So after that, I'm not going to say very much. Except that this, just to repeat, is a tremendous honour from a unique educational organisation, university, which has now spread all over the world. And having seen some of the remarkable things they do, and many of these are transmitted on our television sets, presented by famous presenters in terms of space research, in terms of the environment, in terms of animals research in Africa, it's quite a remarkable effort that these people put in. I wish the Open University every good wish in the future. Thank you very much.
Pro-Vice-Chancellor, I shall now present graduates who have gained higher degrees and have been able to attend here today. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, I present to you for a thesis entitled "The Bacterial Ecology and Function from a Subsurface Critical Zone," Stephen Summers. I present to you for the degree of Master of Arts in English, Irene Cummings. Sarah Haig. Aileen Lobben. McKinnon. David Parry. And Penny Wilson. For the degree of Master of Arts in History, I present Kirsty McFadden. For the degree of Master of Arts in Online and Distance Education, I present Graham Arnott. And Colin Brown. For the degree of Master of Business Administration, I present Bill Anderson. Karen Beggs. Christopher Beresford. Richard Corbridge. George Dyer Wilson. Klaus Conwellin. Ivo Kupski. Darren Oyston. Ollie Stevenson. Catherine Styler. And Joanna Wood. For the degree of Master of Business Administration, Technology Management, I present Catherine Chaffin. For the degree of Master of Education, with distinction, I present Nelson Liddell. For the degree of Master of Education, I present Caroline Taylor. And Teresa Wilkin. For the degree of Master of Science in Advancing Healthcare Practice, I present Marina Forbes. Nikki Forsyth. Nesta McCluskey. And Jane Oldham. For the degree of Master of Science in Computing for Commerce and Industry, I present Tom Morris. For the degree of Master of Science in Science with Distinction, I present Karen Prince. And for the degree of Master of Science in Science, I present Jacqueline Caldwell.
Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, graduates, guests. James Robertson has made an exceptional contribution to both culture and education in Scotland as a poet and award-winning novelist and as a publisher of poetry and of children's books in Scots. He is an influential advocate for the revitalization of the Scots language and for raising the aspirations and self-esteem of Scots speakers. James was born in 1958 in Kent, in his own words, about as far from here as you can get without falling into the channel. He was six when his family settled in Bridge of Allen, and he says that he felt immediately as though he had come home. He was 10 when he was given a portable typewriter and took his first steps to being a writer. He read history at Edinburgh University, where he later returned to complete a PhD on Sir Walter Scott. History, Scottish literature, language, and culture all influence his work. In his poems and in his novels, he explores Scottish character in political and social history. His work attracts attention, and he has notably twice received the Saltire Book of the Year Award for Joseph Knight in 2003 and again in 2010 for his epic And the Land Lay Still. James also has the distinction of being the first writer in residence at the poet Hugh McDermott's former home, Brownsbank, a position he held from 1993 to 1995. And he has been writer in residence at the Scottish Parliament and at Edinburgh Napier University. As well as being a renowned writer, James runs what has been described as a little gem of a publishing firm, Catalonia, which publishes pamphlets of new, experimental, and neglected Scottish writing. He set up the firm as a way of publishing his poems. It's hard to believe now, but when James started out, he had limited success in getting his poems published. But with the same kind of gritty determination and can-do spirit, which is typical of an Open University student, James decided to publish them himself, and so Catalonia was born. In 2002, he co-founded with Matthew Fitt and the Edinburgh-based publisher Black and White Publishing, Ichiku. This was an educational and community outreach project aimed at getting Scots language literature into schools, with books for the children and support for the teachers. Ichiku publishes a wide range of children's books in Scots and has helped to raise the confidence of children, parents, and teachers in using the Scots language. This places his work alongside the Open University's mission of social justice and widening access to educational opportunities. While the outreach element of the Ichiku project has now ended, The imprint continues to publish and make children's favourites available in Scots, including James's translation of Winnie the Pooh and the Gruffalo and the works of Roald Dahl. The Open University in Scotland has developed a strong relationship with James over the past few years. We have supported a number of his talks at book festivals, including the Ullapool Book Festival, of which James was the honorary president from 2010 to 2014. And we have been grateful for his encouragement in developing a unique, free, online learning resource about Gaelic for the university's OpenLearn website, and more recently, a similar development on the Scots language. James has devoted much of his career to actively promoting Scottish culture, and in particular, the Scots language, both through his own work and through liaison with national and local government, educational institutions, and literary organizations. He has an untiring passion for Scotland and has secured himself a powerful legacy in enhancing Scotland's creative self-belief. Pro Vice Chancellor, by the authority of the Senate, I present to you for the degree of Doctor of the University, James Robertson.
Vice-Chancellor, graduates, guests, I am most grateful for the honour that you've bestowed on me today, not least because I wholeheartedly support the Open University's commitment to social justice and its founding principle of enabling access to education to all who want it and can benefit from it. Among the human rights that we should hold dear are these, that nobody should be denied access to their own culture, and that their language should not be repressed, neglected, or derided by the apparatus of the state in which they live. And for long periods of our history, speakers of Scots and of Gaelic, but I'm particularly speaking of Scots, have found themselves on the receiving end of just such repression, neglect, and derision. Until very recently, Scots was almost completely excluded from the education system, and bairns who used it in the classroom were punished for doing so, except, ironically, on the one day of the year when Robert Burns, our national bard, was celebrated for his writing, the bulk of which was in good braid Scots. I'm pleased to say that officially sanctioned prejudice against Scots language is on the decrease. Only this week, I was at the launch of the first ever qualification in the study of Scots developed for our school education system. However, even among those who use the language habitually, many misconceptions remain, including the idea that Scots is merely slang or bad English. In 2011, for the first time ever, the National Census asked questions about the Scots language. And the data that was received revealed that 1.5 million people, or 28% of the population, said that they spoke Scots, and 1.9 million, or 35%, said that they could speak, read, write, or understand it. Whatever the arguments about the status, definition, or health of Scots, these figures confirm that it is part of the lives of hundreds of thousands and that it permeates the social and cultural life of this country. Scots language has a rich and varied literature, both written and oral. The earliest examples of written Scots are 700 years old, And whether in poetry, fiction, ballad, song or story, the tradition continues to this day. And I share with the Open University the aspiration that this literature should be available to all to be enjoyed and studied. And I hope that these census figures will act as an incentive to make that more of a reality than it currently is. To today's graduates, I'd like to finish by just quoting two writers whose works have been a great influence on me in my life. And the first writer is Hugh McDermott, in whose cottage I lived for a couple of years, as has already been mentioned. It was a great incentive to get up in the morning to find 20 or 30 pictures of Hugh McDermott staring down from the walls at you. In his poem, A Drunk Man Looks at the Thistle, he offers this advice. And let the lesson be to be yourselves. You need na fash gan it's to be ocht else, to be yourselves, and to mak that worth being. Nae harder job to mortals has been gien. And the second writer I'll quote to you is Robert Louis Stevenson, who says pretty much the same thing, but slightly differently. To be what we are and to become what we are capable of becoming is the only end of life. I thank you again, Pro-Vice-Chancellor, and I wish all the graduates today every success in the pursuit of that end.
Pro-Vice-Chancellor, we now come to the part of today's ceremony that marks the presentation of graduates who have gained a first degree and who have been able to attend here today. The full subject and classification details are printed in the Directory of Graduates. I present to you for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with First Class Honours, Christine Bell. Barbara Blackie. Jane Collinson. Josephine Craig. Helen Gibson. Colin Hughes. George Lowe. Greg Hunt. Leanne Jones. Michael Kelly. Sue Lessons. Elizabeth McGee. Lorraine Nutt. Sarah O'Reilly. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts with Honours, I present Catherine Adams. Yvonne Barry. Carolyn Bean. Maureen Boyd. Alison Green. Carol Butler. Karen Carraher. Diana Cleland. David Cooper. Duncan Craig. Kirsty Denham. Linda Donnelly. Kenneth Fiskin. Sarah Louise Fleming. Lynn Forrest. Alan Garth. Brian Glass. Bruce Gordon. Maria Fernanda Guerra Ferrada. Andrew Howie. William Laird. Iona Livingston. Tony Masterson. Mark McCabe. Miriam Mackay. Francis Mullen. Douglas Munro. Cheech Murray. Patricia Piper. Michael Purvis. Susan Rennie. Fiona Rowan. Adrian Sanderson. Mara Signori. Jacqueline Stewart. Glenn Stone. David Tallock. Silky Tigersman. Claire Tinney. Emma Veach. Karen Webb. Maria Yarker. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts, I present Antoinette Hudson. Joanna Henry. Frank McGroarty. Rosemary Reeve. Sharon Singer. Sheila Yule. For the degree of Bachelor of Engineering with Honours, I present Lee Bell. David Berry. John Farker. Miroslav Gariki, James McLean, Elizabeth Mennery, Neil Morgan, Gordon Phillip, Brett Short, Amanda Tate, for the degree of Bachelor of Laws with First Class Honours, I present Tony McShane. For the degree of Bachelor of Laws with Honours, I present Alison Aruna. Caroline Cunningham. For the degree of Bachelor of Science with First Class Honours, I present Susan Bryan. Stephen Caldwell. Robert Gibson. And Lisa Thompson. For two Bachelor of Science with Honours degrees, I present Ungumetsi Anuche. For the degree of Bachelor of Science with Honours, I present Rothi Amirida. Orshi Bailey. Amanda Banerjee. Karen Barber. Archie Blair. Yeah. Margaret Blunt. Raymond Braid. Judith Brown. Neil Campbell. Steve Carstairs. Lorna Cohen. Stuart Cope. Ruben Crespo Ruiz. Richard Crossland. Enid Davey. Tracy Gorey. Neil Gregory. William Griffiths. Richard Harrison. Scott Herrett. James Igo. Michael Keenan. Judith Koganov. Caroline Lancaster. Michaela Leach. Rachel Lloyd. Kevin McElroy. Sean McGovern. Carolyn McPherson. Caroline Meehan. Moira Miller. Nicholas Milne. Glenn Pierce. Lyndon Proud. Leslie Reeves. Sarah Richardson. Suzanne Stevens. Michelle Stewart. Robert Travis Smith. George Walker. Lynn Walker. Claire Whitten. Kay Wilson. For the degree of Bachelor of Science, I present Scott Barr. Julie Dickinson. Felicity Fullwood. Martin Kerrigan. Brian Law. Keith McKessick. Adam McLean. Fiona McWhirter. Keith Murray. Richard Meek. Ryan Patterson. Moira Robertson. Margaret Semple. Marion Spence. Leanne Thompson. Natalie Walker. And Neil Wright. And for the Diploma of Higher Education, I present David Cripps. Robert Muchiri. And Andy Perrott.
I always love seeing the faces that come across to me across the stage. Sometimes there's fear, sometimes there's tears, sometimes there's half a smile, but by the time they leave there's a big smile. And all your applause, I think, really helps them as they go across. Because it's a lot more nervous-making than you expect, actually, when you get to that point where you have to cross the stage. So I hope you've enjoyed that experience this morning. So let me just welcome everybody again. Thank you for coming today. All the graduates, all our guests, the staff, just everyone who's here. It's a wonderful day for us all, and it's great to share it with so many of you. 2014 marks our 40th anniversary of the first OU graduation in Scotland. At the first graduation in the Assembly Rooms in Edinburgh in April 1974, 260 students graduated. Since then, over 63,000 professional qualifications and degrees have been awarded by the Open University in Scotland. Recently, Education Secretary Michael Russell said, "The Open University has changed the way we looked at higher education, and its flexible approach is now being adopted by many others to give more and more people the opportunity to study in a way that suits their individual circumstances." The OU's accessibility is its greatest asset. Over the years, the number of students and courses has grown, as has the number of students with disabilities, those combining study with work, and those returning to education later in life. I would like to congratulate all of this year's graduates who are following in the footsteps of the thousands of previous successful students and look forward to marking more landmark anniversaries for the Open University. People in Scotland will vote on whether to leave the UK in the independence referendum on the 18th of September. The Open University already successfully operates as a UK-wide and international education organisation. The university's flexibility means that whatever the constitutional settlement in Scotland is, the OU remains committed to delivering accessible, high-quality and value-for-money education. Edinburgh is also known as the festival city, due to the large number of arts festivals that take place over the summer, including the Edinburgh International Book Festival, which the Open University also sponsors. The BBC drama, combined BBC-OU drama, Castles in the Sky, based on the Scotsman Robert Watson Watt, who invented the radar, was played recently by Eddie Izzard, is premiering across the road from the Usher Hall at the Film House on Monday the 23rd at the Edinburgh Film Festival. So I hope you'll go and see it. But I'm delighted to be here on this special occasion to mark the occasion first and foremost for the celebrating of your achievements for those of you graduating here today. Our youngest graduate is 23 and our oldest is 86. And we also have three members of our own staff graduating today as well. I'd like to give a special note of thanks to all our staff who are here with us and for the careful planning and organisation which goes into making this day a special one. For me, this day is a special one too, as I've been able to congratulate each of you personally. I hear the applause of your well wishes and try to calm your nervousness as you cross the stage. I love your grins, your shyer smiles, and even the hand grips that at times make my hand ache. I hope I put it back as hard as you give it to me. I too hope that your gown wouldn't trip you, that your shoes wouldn't make you stumble, and that you look pretty good as you walk across that stage, taking this moment with dignity and pride, and hopefully remembering it as you go back to your seat.
This ceremony gives us all an opportunity to acknowledge your success, and it gives you the chance to reflect on what it means for you. It's an opportunity for us all to be mindful. The ceremony passes all too quickly, given the years of persistence and sheer willpower to keep going as your lives, personal, social, study and work all engulf you at the same time. Can you remember your last submission and how that felt? So graduates, sit back and consider your success, what it means to you and those around you. And for those who have helped you in this journey, be reminded of the roles that you have each played and the impact this achievement will make on those closest to you for future offerings and more broadly, the global world that we live in. But it's not just your achievement, it's ours too, the universities. The advisor in registrations who handled your first, perhaps hesitant telephone inquiry, the academics who design and wrote your courses, the associate lecturers who support you, your tutors, the student support staff, and the list could go on. Of course, our associate lecturers, the men and women who guided you through the whole OU learning experience from the moment you registered on your course to the moment you crossed the stage today, and many of them are here with us to celebrate your success. Every one of us at the Open University has a little stake in what you've accomplished, and believe me, every one of us is bursting with pride when we say we are celebrating with you. So let's just take a moment, though, to thank those at the Open University who've made this all possible. So I'll ask our staff to stand, please, and if we could congratulate them for all the hard work that they have given in helping you be as successful as you are. Please stand. They're not the only ones to help you reach your goals, so I've only just got it started in terms of celebrating and clapping. It's not easy being an OU student, and I know that many of you completed your studies while holding down full-time, demanding, challenging jobs, looking after your families and overcoming tremendous obstacles along the way. But I also know there's only one thing harder than being an OU student, and perhaps that's living with an Open University student. So we should also pay tribute to your family and friends. We should pay tribute to them for supporting you when you were getting going, for standing by you when things were getting tough, and for celebrating with you now in your moment of glory. So I would like to ask the graduates to please stand, face your family members, and give them a round of applause for all the help they've given you. Possessors of an Open University qualification. I'm sure that your long journey today's celebration will have been demanding. You'll have had to plan carefully and manage your time. You'll have needed considerable self-discipline, persistence, and commitment to complete your award. These personal qualities will always be with you. Maybe you developed a few more. Perhaps you've learned about yourself in ways that those around you may not outwardly recognise, but you will know what these are. You have developed skills that will enable you to contribute to multiple ways to the world that we live in. Your creative and critical thinking skills, your ability to craft arguments, analyse ideas, and your knowledge in a range of discipline areas, bringing relevance to your work, personal and social lives. Your self-motivation, your newfound communication skills, your ability to reflect, and new professional behaviours relevant to the multiple contexts with which we operate. You also represent everything that our modern world needs, in that you have demonstrated your ability to contribute these skills through your workplaces, your communities, local and international organisations, and with your families. You are the kind of people that society needs. I hope that your journey won't stop here and you'll keep coming back for more. Today should be the start of your lifelong learning journey. But the Open University is very special. There's nothing quite like it anywhere in the world, even though it's helped establish many other open universities across the globe. We're innovative on so many levels, and with our advances in technology, you've been able to use the new OU Anywhere app, which recently won 2 Guardian Awards, of which we're very proud. As a university, we have launched FutureLearn, and along with 29 partners, have approximately 700,000 course sign-ups registered on a variety of free courses. And of course, here in Scotland, Glasgow, Edinburgh and Strathclyde and Aberdeen are all members of that network. We've also been given £1.27 million to lead a sector-wide project on developing expertise in open education practice in Scotland. And the Scottish Government has awarded grants to the OU in Scotland to develop free online materials for self-directed support, which has been instrumental in ensuring carers and those for whom they provide care can access all of the appropriate assistance that they require. I know many of you here have also been dipping into some of our informal learning courses, and I hope you will continue to do that. Your study with us does not have to be formal, it can be informal, and there's more than 10,000 free learning objects for you to dip into. Our learning and teaching results in the national survey, you've consistently rated us top 5 universities, and for the student experience. We're so grateful for that. Thank you so much for your support. But even better, you have rated us in Scotland since 2005 as number 1 in overall student satisfaction. So thank you from us. Our research ranks highly, and we've much to be proud of as we go into the next round of the research rankings. We collaborate here in Scotland too, for example, with Inogen at the University of Edinburgh and social marketing at the University of Stirling. You can be so very, very, very proud of your university. So before I conclude, I'll ask one last time for all our graduates to stand and for everyone here to join me in giving you the loudest and biggest round of applause that you will receive today. Please stand. Ceremony are now completed, and I declare the meeting of this congregation closed. The piper will now provide us with a musical farewell, at the end of which I would ask all of those who are able to stand to please do so.